think it's a feature of all the Northrop airplanes that have come down the line, that they have always been unafraid to try something new. They've been making original shapes that work for 50 years.
It's a company and a culture that sponsors creativity. And the way you do
that... I think curiosity has a heck of a lot to do with it.
The motivation has to come with the constant recognition of people on the floor. You have to get out.
Just the mentioning of Northrop is like, oh, we're related, you know, we're coming.
Jack Northrop listened to my ideas. Tom Jones came in and he listened to my ideas. I stayed for 49 years and I may stay another 49.
In the years I've been flying Northrop aircraft, advanced technology has taken tremendous strides, and a lot of that has come from work being done at Northrop. There's been breakthroughs almost everywhere you look, in avionics and low observability, so-called stealth technologies, composite materials, guidance systems, electronic countermeasures, manufacturing, you name it. And if you know Northrop like I do, I can tell you these things don't just happen. They come about through a lot of hard work by people. The scientists, the engineers, the test pilots, the folks on the manufacturing floor. There are 44,000 people working at Northrop today. 44,000 distinct voices. Each one tells part of the story.
My manufacturing people truly believe that quality begins with me, that each one of them takes pride in everything they do.
I like quality work. I like it done right. Aircraft has to be something quality. It's going to be in the air for 20 years or better.
I realize I don't design anything, I don't build anything, I don't fly anything. All I do is create an environment for people to create.
You try to make sure that when your customer needs something, you're there to satisfy his needs. You have to make sure that the people that you have on the floor are able to perform to that standard.
To me, it's serving my country. But if I do my job well here, almost impeccably, then it's very possible that I am serving my country, because the job that I'm doing, someone's life is actually depending on it.
I've always had the philosophy that the tools you use to build things are as important as the things you build. You should own your tools.
And I believe we own 98% just about of our own facilities. And I think we're a rare breed in this industry.
We had to invest a huge amount of money to be able to do the B-2. Now, that was not government money. That was Northrop money.
The IMPCA project. It's for the control of assembly processes, watching what we did do, and also for the planning of deciding what we're going to do next.
When the IMPCA program came in, it was just like, to me, just me on a personal level, I'd say it's a lot easier for me. I love it.
The trick of the business is to anticipate where the customer is going to go. What's he going to need 2 or 3 years from now? It has to be with a technology that's achievable, one that'll work every time.
But it all boils down to the same thing. If you have a very reliable product, in the long term, it's going to be less expensive to maintain and to own than if you have something that breaks.
We put a high value on individuality, but the thing that ties it together is the common objective. And they know that when they come up with good ideas, they're going to be supported very quickly.
If you take a risk and you fail, they don't punish you. So you're not afraid to take another risk and learn something. I think it all goes back to John Northrop's entrepreneurial spirit.
I had a little drafting board at home, and in the latter part of 1926, I laid out a high wing.
Thank you.
there's a kind of integrity that I suppose a good creative artist has. And out of that comes good products.
That military customer is important, and what he thinks about our product is important, and also the people that are going to be using it on the flight line. I worry about how can you make advanced technology work for them, which generally means you're looking with them at their future 15 years ahead.
To think of how to make it producible when you put the first line on the paper. Now, I think that is uniquely Northrop.
It's important to understand that when we talk about accuracy, we talk about machining tolerances in the millionths of an inch.
Well, I've been doing electronics hybrids, especially for 20 years. So I do like Northrop. I really do. It's the people, too. It makes a lot of
manager.
Difference.
The manager.
The manager. It makes a lot of difference. Yes.
This is what you're trying to do. You're trying to make sure that you can deliver a reliable instrument for a reasonable cost.
The first thing we do, and I think the one that most people have heard about, is the Peacekeeper IMU, okay, which is the most precise inertial navigation system ever built. And we build an internal structure, which we call the ball. It floats in a neutrally buoyant state.
If you're a craftsman, there's no greater feeling than to see that small part that you have made end up in the end product and then see the end product performing.
From me. It's at 2,000 feet, Mach 1.7, headed southwest.
One will take the one headed north.
Okay.
Oh, there they are.
Three's got the south guy.
Mine is turning to east at 31,000.
I'm Fox 1, active.
I got one active.
Range 10 miles.
Red 1, Sam warning. Sam warning. Don't cross the FIBA.
He's right on top of you, 1. I got a launch on me, 3.
Beat the missile and heading home.
Okay, I've got one right in front of me.
We've always been at the best when we understand. What is it the military wants to accomplish?
And you're fine.
Well, if you look around the company from the planning side and the systems analysis side all the way down to the simulators, we have people working with the customer.
Guy to the north is 1.8, 29,000 feet.
We're working daily with the TAC pilots and the aggressor pilots to understand not only how the cockpit should be designed, but what kind of tactics need to be developed to exploit a system like the ATF.
Okay, we're starting.
All right.
Hands clear.
Clear. Clear. Clear.
40 years ago, we didn't have fancy simulators like this one at Northrop. On a few occasions, I wish we did. You can learn a lot about airplanes and simulators, and they're especially helpful to the engineers and test pilots. But it's when you get to actually fly the aircraft, that's where pilots like me are most comfortable. There's an old adage among fighter pilots, if it looks good, it flies good. And that's true of all Northrop airplanes, especially the T-38. By the time the T-38 is retired in the next century, it will have been in service with the U.S. Air Force for nearly 50 years. I've flown the F-5 many times, and I can tell you it was to fighters what old Sugar Ray Robinson was to boxers, pound for pound the best in the business, a pilot's airplane. The FA-18, which grew out of Northrop's work on the Cobra and the YF-17 prototype, is another fun airplane to fly. Those unique twin-canted tails and the big leading edge extensions has done a lot to change people's thinking about fighter maneuverability.
The B-2 is a superb example of the inherent technological advantage of a free enterprise system and of a free society.
Thank you.
I think the major thing that the T-38 does, it teaches the young pilots the speed, the maneuverability, and the situational awareness that they're going to need as they progress into the future aircraft.
The F-18 is an absolute winner. The pilots love it, it's a pilot's airplane, and as a battle group commander, I love it because of what it allows me to do.
Well, the F-5 was a major breakthrough in technology in its own way.
You could do just about anything in it and not get into trouble. It was quick, agile, and reliable, and damn hard to see.
The F-20 never met a pilot that didn't like it. They all loved it.
There isn't anything in today's airplanes or the next generation airplanes that won't be sensitive to computers in some way. Without the F-20, we would never have been competitive on the ATF.
If you understand it enough, there's a simple solution to everything. And the most sophisticated thing in the world is the simplest thing.
I think everybody who's been involved with this airplane is really in love with it.
I felt the euphoric because I like to see an end product. And because when you look at something like that, you know how many hours of a day of somebody's life went into producing something like that. And so you know that it took a great deal to roll that plane out.
Nothing wrong with trying to be perfect. You'll end up at least being damn good.